Good morning, everyone. So myself, Dr. Rajshekar, and I'll be dealing with several different areas for groups here. Okay. To give you a little bit of background, my major education is in biology, molecular biology, biotechnology, and things like that. And I've done my master's and PhDs in biochemistry. And I've been teaching here for last like 6-7 months. I've done several batches of general science, basically. Okay, so there are people from both group 1 and group 2 here. So whatever we are, basically we cover the same concept for group 1 and group 2, but we'll have slightly different depth that you require for each of them. And of course, you know, when you take the coaching like this, it is useful for both of those. So you have a choice to choose what type of exams you want to appear, right? And I would like to know before starting to talk about anything else, like the background. I want to get an idea about the type of background you all have. Anyone from biology here, like at your degree level, intermediate level, biology background? Okay. How many from engineering? Right, so most of you are from engineering background. Anybody from other areas, computer science, commerce? Okay, there are a few people from that, right? And given my specialization in biology, and one of the most important thing I notice from students is some of you may be scared of biology, or some of you hate biology. Hate in the sense, most of the times hate doesn't come from, you know, actual thought process, but comes from, you know, that is something difficult to understand. And most of this starts from our schooling age. In our school, sometimes our teachers influence us differently. I'm sure some of you got inspired from your teachers because they teach well, right? In a way, our future is defined by the teachers that we get in the school. Okay? Some of us, like me, I took biology because I was scared of math. But there are different forces that act on us, right? But later you realize, you get the actual taste of, you know, subjects once you dwell into it and once you start studying about it. Okay, but maybe there are different reasons for why we like things and why we don't like things. But end of the day, what matters is, for the exam point of view, if you really prepared well to the exam. And I strongly believe that unless you start liking something, you cannot put enough efforts into it. Nothing that we are preparing towards should not become a hurdle to us. You know, you should not sit with books and hate doing it every time. It doesn't work really well. Okay, so we have to develop an attitude that helps us to spend enough time in studying the concepts you need and prepare well towards the exam. Okay, and me, I deal with, in general science, I teach here biology, I teach physics, I also teach chemistry, and I also teach science and technology. Okay, and of course I teach different institutes as well. I also teach biology and these basics, and at brains. Sorry, I was thinking about Dr. D.V. Kumar Institute. I teach there, and I also teach at the Braintree Institute. Okay, but my core area is bio and science and technology. And science and technology, I teach for mains. I talk about trends in life sciences, new trends in life sciences, section 2. Teach about all aspects of genetic engineering, immunology, and plants, animals, resources, diseases. So starting with the basics, starting with the biology concepts and biology, physics, and chemistry, do you know how many questions are you getting from these three areas? An average. Okay, out of 150 questions that you have in prelims, on average, you get about 25 questions coming from all these areas. Okay, comparable to what you get from current affairs and GK. So again, a very crucial area for you to actually have hold on. And out of 25 questions, if you look at biology, on average, there are about 15 questions coming from biology. Okay, and physics and chemistry. Seems like, if you look at the trend, physics you are getting an average about 7 questions, chemistry you are getting about 3 questions. So about 25 questions coming from these areas. Okay, and out of 25 questions, the majority goes to biology part. And sometimes you see a trend, physics will have slightly less questions, maybe 3 or 4 questions from physics, but chemistry will have about 6 questions or 5 questions from that. So overall, there are about 25 questions. I think only one time in about 1999, there were 50 questions come from that area. Okay, but an average, the trend is, they make sure that you get around 25 questions, because general science is one component of that which is essential for us. Okay, so you are aiming in getting these 25 marks from the courses that I teach here, leaving aside the science S&T mains part. Okay, let me first focus on talking a little bit more about this. What do we learn? What do I teach in biology? What kind of areas do I cover in physics? What kind of areas do I cover in chemistry? Okay, biology. Okay, you all studied biology at your high school level. Biology means we study different aspects of general science. We study about us humans, we study about animals, we study about plants, right? And also we study about things that we cannot even see. Microorganisms, are they useful to us? Are the microorganisms useful to us? Yes. How many of them are useful? Like, what percentage of them are useful to us and what percent of them are harmful to us? Do they only do good things to us, or do they only do bad things to us? They do both, right? Most of the challenges that we have from microorganisms, if you open the newspaper, you hear about cases of dengue, you hear about the cases of Zika, hear about the cases that comes due to tuberculosis and those kind of diseases that we always have been suffering from, right? But in addition to that, sometimes, you know, we have to learn about things such as plants. We have to worry about plants, and we utilize microorganisms in supporting the growth of plants. Biotechnology, if you talk about biological origin of things, biofertilizers, for example, you're using microorganisms. So microorganisms not only cause disease in us, they're helping plants to survive and they're helping humans to survive. Can you give one example where microorganisms help us greatly these days? What is it? Sorry? Think about this. We take antibiotics, right? One common symptom, side effects that you get from antibiotics is diarrhea. What causes diarrhea? Because this particular type of antibiotics called broad spectrum antibiotics, they kill all sorts of microorganisms in our intestine. And we get help from these microorganisms in the digestion process. So if you remove all those microorganisms from the intestine, it will develop diarrhea. That is why doctors ask you to eat some curd, which is very common here, we eat curd, to replace that microorganisms, right? So on top of that, not only helping us in the process of digestion, for example, it also produces vitamins. Vitamin B, for example, most of us, most vegetarians experience problem with vitamin B deficiency. And vitamin B, an essential vitamin for producing energy in metabolic reactions. So if you have vitamin B deficiency, how do you feel? You feel very weak. You don't feel like, you know, working, doing anything, right? Very small problem, but your microorganisms can make vitamin B for you. Okay, so they not only produce disease, they help us in multiple different ways. They are part of most of our body, and they compete with other microorganisms. There are microorganisms which cause infection in us, right? But having other microorganisms, other bacteria, will have a competition with other pathogenic microorganisms. So they help us overcoming the diseases. So there are many, many, many aspects of microorganisms. In today's world, I'm not talking about naturally what microorganisms are working in our body. Do you know that how we make insulin? The insulin injections that we take, you know, where are they made? In bacteria, in E. coli, in yeast. Okay, very small microorganisms, but they're acting like industries to make insulin for us. Because, you know, if you have diabetes, very common problem in India, right? Diabetes is caused due to any problems to do with insulin, or problems how our body responds to insulin. We talk about diabetes mellitus, type 1 diabetes, type 2 diabetes, right? Type 2 diabetes is the most common form of the diabetes. How do we treat it? There are some medicines for it, but at the same time, people do use insulin injections. Who produces insulin naturally? Humans. But can we go and beg someone, can you give us some insulin? Like the way we ask, can you give some salt? Can you give some sugar? Can I borrow some salt from you? We cannot ask them to give us hormones. right? Somehow we have to produce them commercially. Okay, in traditional days, what people used to do, they used to get these things from animals, pigs, cows. They used to get hormones from them. But you know, of course, they won't satisfy the needs because a huge population in India is suffering from diabetes. The best way is to utilize microorganisms to make insulin for us. And biotechnology more specifically handles this, and actually companies here, right here in Hyderabad, okay, biotech companies making this. And there are companies like Shanta Biotech making vaccines for us, hepatitis B vaccine, produced in bacteria right here in Hyderabad. Okay, so like that, there are a range of applications, natural applications of microorganisms in our body, or applications that are due to biotechnology or the new inventions. So that's about microorganisms. When we come to plants, are plants really useful to us? Can we survive without plants? No, but we actually behave as if we can survive. We don't mind cutting the trees and building the houses, building the companies. We don't care, but we all know that inherently we are able to survive because of plants. Okay, and having basic knowledge about how plants work. Okay, what type of system do plants have? Do plants have any similarities to us? Right, are there plants living? Right, do you know who is the scientist who actually explained this concept? Dr. Jagadish Chandra Bose. Right, he first discovered and demonstrated that plants also have life. They breathe like us, and in fact they breathe and give what we need to breathe, that is oxygen. They reduce the pollution around here. They take the carbon dioxide in. They make food for us. Okay, some of you may like only animals but not plants, but we all know that animals survive on plants too. So in a way we all live on plants, right? Through energy, it traps the energy from sun and makes the photosynthesis and makes the food that we require. So all these things are possible because of plants. Either you're talking about the food that is essential for us to survive, or the oxygen that we are breathing essential for us to survive, okay? Or even medicines, Ayurveda, we know how many herbal medicines do we use. So we look at two different aspects of plants, plant physiology, what are the different aspects, photosynthesis, respiration, how respiration happens. Do plants actually sweat? Do plants sweat? What is that phenomena called? Transpiration. Plants also sweat. Do they have sweat pores? They have small pores and throughout their body, especially on the leaves. Okay? So we will see how do they do it, and what is the link between transpiration, that is sweating in plants, and taking up carbon dioxide inside. Why some plants don't have leaves? Cactus, for example. Why doesn't it have leaves? It's a kind of adaptation towards the environment. It wants to lose less water. It wants to sweat less. Okay, we'll talk about these aspects in plants. We'll talk about several different types, for example, hormones. Like we have hormones in our body, plants also have hormones. What type of hormones? We hear in the news, for example, for artificial ripening, ethylene is normally used, and they use carbide. Okay, once you understand the concept about the fundamental concept about why hormones are needed in the plants, you will understand why people use carbide and why using carbide is a problem. So you will get the fundamental understanding about different things, either microorganisms, plants or animals, not only to be able to score this about 15 questions coming from biology, but also being able to understand and digest the concepts from other areas such as science and technology, and being able to understand why people are talking about antibiotic resistance. It's a huge buzzword in news, right? Do you all know what antibiotic resistance is? What are antibiotics? I'm sure you all know antibiotics, right? Hyderabad is a kind of a hub, pharma hub. Okay, we have companies making enormous amounts of antibiotics. What do we use antibiotics for? Okay, one suggestion I always give students, wherever it is, I've come through the same process myself. We all have very good, very complicated brains, right? The reason why I'm saying complicated, animals also have brains. But when it comes to us, we have more developed, we have intelligence concept, which is may not be the part of animals. But there is one big problem with the intelligence part of our brain. Do you know what is that? we think too much. Sometimes we don't have to think too much at all. The problem of most of the issues in our life is because of our thinking. You all know that, right? If you have one small thing, different people respond differently to that. People seeing lizards, some people actually jump from their chairs, right? To the person who doesn't even care. Where is the difference coming from? We all have same sorts of eyes, we all have same sorts of brain, but some of us think too much about it. So one side effect of that I see in the class is, when someone asks to answer a question, we don't think about question too much. We think about what if it is wrong. What person thinking next to me sitting thinks about me. What teacher would think about me. We think about too many other things than the actual thing that we need to focus. Is it not right? This is how even I was. Even maybe if I sit there, probably I'll behave the same way. But as a student and as a teacher, I realize that most of the times we lose because we don't actually come up with the actual thought process that we need to. So in the class, don't worry about anything. I think as soon as sir comes into the class, people start thinking where he might be. Why is he dressing like this? What kind of accent he has? You know, did he study in Telugu medium? Did he study in English medium? Is he from Andhra? Is he from Telangana? Is he North Indian? These questions actually keep coming in our brain and taking lot of our energy. I think brain is one of the key part in our body which consumes lot of energy. Even when you are sleeping, it is consuming energy for us, isn't it? So focus on this. Focusing in the sense, don't worry about anything else. Worry about in the class, if someone is teaching like this, is there anything that's useful to me? And I will let you know that nobody, including me, that I'm going to tell you in next few months, I will teach you all the biology, all the physics, all the chemistry. That is not practically right. I'm not going to teach anything that you have not learnt in last 15 or 16 years from your schooling. But I'm going to consolidate it. I'm going to give you the overview that you need, the approach that you need to understand. I will lay the foundation for you to learn more. Okay? I'll only skim through different aspects, different topics that may be useful for you in the exam. Like why we need antibiotic resistance, things like that. But in the class, if you really want to get most out of this, forget most of the other things. Just sit in the class, focus, learn things. And as soon as you go out, you should learn more than what you learned the day before. That's it. That should be the simple concept. If sir asks something, answer it. If it is wrong, I'll correct it. There are only two aspects, right? Either you know it right or you don't know it. Fine. And I give a couple of options in my class. I tell them, do you agree with this? Because I don't get an answer when I ask. This is common with any batch. Okay? And if they don't say anything, I'll ask, do you know it? If you don't know it, do you know that you don't know it? Right? And some people actually smile. That's option three. They're not sure, they're confused. Okay? So like that, I'll give you not four options, three options. Either you know it, say it. If you don't know, that's fine. And if neither of these, you smile. It's fine. Okay? But the concept is learning. And learning happens the day we are born. Okay? Focus on that rather than focusing on what other things about you. Because end of the day, you are going to get benefit out of this if you clear these exams and enjoy the benefits of this. Right? And people who are connected to you will like it. Others, you don't care about it. So don't make it complicated. Okay? If you know something, tell me that you know it. If you don't know, that's fine. So what is antibiotic resistance? Exactly. So you mentioned bacteria. Do we use antibiotics to treat bacterial infections? Yes or no? Yes. Do we only use antibiotics to treat bacterial infection? I rephrased my question. Okay. We can use for? I think I have a difficulty in getting that. Can we use antibiotics for virus? Okay. See, this is a very good actually problem to work on. Do we all hear about antibiotic resistance in the news? Okay. So in any competitive exam, they expect you to know the fundamentals related to this concept so that you will be able to answer questions. So we are trying to answer few things here. First, we need to understand antibiotics are drugs, right? These are actually referred to as magic bullets because this helped us in quite many different ways, especially beginning from World War II. Using penicillin, the first antibiotic that is discovered by Who discovered it? Alexander Fleming. At the groups level, they will ask you questions like this. Who discovered this? Famous scientist, Jagadish Chandra Bose, I talked about. Alexander Fleming, I talked about. And what he did? He discovered penicillin. And penicillin is a type of antibiotic. And this antibiotic, we are today talking about an issue with antibiotics. What is that issue? This bacteria is developing resistance to antibiotics. But even before reaching there, you need to know what antibiotics are used for. My question is, is it used for bacteria or virus? Some of you think they are used for both. Some of you think it's only used for bacteria. Okay? What do you need to know to answer this question? At the basic level, without getting into the details, you need to know how antibiotics work. The couple of ways antibiotics, these are drugs, right? The pills that we take, or capsules sometimes if you're taking amoxicillin. So what happens in these cases? They actually cleave. Do you know that bacteria has a cell wall around it? A wall around it. So it will attack the cell wall and cleave the cell wall of the bacteria. This is one way of how antibiotics kill some microorganisms such as bacteria. And it also, do you all know that we have proteins? Right? We all have proteins, right? And bacteria also has proteins. Proteins are essential for any living systems. And antibiotics, what do? They actually inhibit the process of protein synthesis. They won't let the microorganism make proteins. There are many other methods, but let's work on these two aspects. There are other ways how it influences the process. If you want to know DNA, for example, it won't let the microorganism make DNA, because unless you have DNA, proteins are not made. Because DNA has information for everything you can think of. All the proteins are made from genes that are located on the DNA. So all these three things, okay, common things how antibiotics actually act on microorganisms. Does bacteria have all these things? Does bacteria have cell wall? Okay, it has cell wall. In the very first class in biology, we'll talk about the cell structure. So it has cell wall. I just talked about it. It has proteins. It has DNA. But what about virus? Does virus have a cell wall? Okay. Maybe you don't know. Virus usually are made up of a protein layer, and inside they have DNA or RNA. Basically a cover outside, a DNA or RNA inside. No concept of cell wall. One of the very simplistic organism. And still people debate whether it is living or non-living. Because it doesn't do respiration like us. It doesn't digest food. Only thing it does is it does infection. It causes infections in us. Still enough. This is one of the most bigger issue than the bacteria. We are worried more about HIV. We are worried more about cancer, which also gets caused by some types of viruses. Like hepatitis B virus. Okay. So, but it doesn't have cell wall. It has DNA and protein. Okay, there are more antibiotics that act on the cell walls. And although it has proteins, we talked about it inhibits the process of protein synthesis. Do you know how virus makes proteins? It cannot make protein itself. It hijacks us. It actually takes over our own body. Instead of making our proteins, virus will make its own proteins in our body. So, can we inhibit the process of protein synthesis in virus? No, because it doesn't have any machinery at all, no tools at all to make it. No tools to make DNA. Can we use antibiotics against virus? None of the targets that antibiotics will act are part of virus. Then, if that is the case, can you use antibiotics to treat viral infections? And antibiotics are not used to treat viral infections. This is the one of the most important conception that we have in countries like us. Okay? Viral, if you go and ask doctor that if you get a viral infection, why is he giving you antibiotics? He will tell you he's giving it not for virus, for secondary infections. Meaning, when you are going through infection, your body is weak, right? We have some bacteria, it will take the opportunity and it will cause disease, like E. coli for example. When that happens, he gives you antibiotics to solve those problems, not to solve viral problems. But we always think it doesn't matter. As soon as you get fever, as soon as you get something like cold or throat infection, you will get antibiotics. And this is actually one reason what is causing antibiotic resistance. And if you clear the groups exams, you will be a very responsible officers. Having a knowledge about what is causing antibiotic resistance is key. Okay? But I'm sure most of you learnt about virus. I'm sure most of you learnt about bacteria. But still, there is something with our education system that we cannot put things together and get what we want for our life. For us, education is different, life is different. Isn't it? That is what I think we need to change. Because it is all kind of, we are learning all these things, spending most of our life because hoping that this knowledge is useful to us. Having the knowledge about biology, physics, chemistry, doesn't matter, engineering, mathematics, somehow it should help us in actually doing well in life. But we always are disconnected from that. Okay? Somehow there's a fundamental flaw in our system or in our brains. But did you understand this concept? So my idea is not to teach something that you don't know, but think, put together things so that you can answer. And you have enough maturity today to be able to grasp it easily and being able to use it. Okay? So this is one reason why antibiotics cannot be used for viruses. There are something called antiviral drugs, which are specially used for viruses. Okay? I will talk about few more things in antibiotic resistance when I teach in the class, but I want to give you an example of how learning biology will help understanding current things in current affairs. What's going on around? Okay? Right. So this is a sample for that. Normally talking about antibiotic resistance. There are so many things. In Hindu paper 2 months ago, we have seen a news. Someone actually, if in Kashi and Varanasi, if you go and take a dip, normally we take a dip in those places, in Ganga, hoping that our sins will be wiped off. That's a belief, right? But looks like we are spreading antibiotic resistance by going there. So it's not that humans are going and meeting there, it's a bacteria that is meeting there and spreading antibiotic resistance. How is that possible? Why is that happening? You need to have certain knowledge, okay, to be able to follow those kind of news. And you get that knowledge from the learning these basic concepts in biology. Okay, so we learn about microorganisms, we learn about plants, we learn about current things connected to and which could be asked in the exam. Okay, and what else? What else do I normally teach in biology? In biology, I talk about microorganisms, plants, and I will cover about human physiology. Okay, do we all have different systems in our body? Do we all have hearts? Do we all have lungs? Do we all have kidneys? Yes, any exceptions here? No, right? We all have it. Does it make sense to learn about them? Okay, let's say that we have some discomfort in stomach. Let's say that we have a chest pain. Let's say that we have headache. Does it help us to know what's happening inside our body? We don't have to be doctors, right? We don't have to know how to treat others. But we need to know what's happening inside our body, right? One reason is we are preparing for the exam. That is essential. But the way I look at it, that if you see a connection to your life, then you don't feel it as a burden. You will learn about it. What you need is a good teacher to teach you these kind of things. Okay? Human physiology, what do you learn here? You will learn how different parts in your body work, how heart works. Because you may get a question on something that sounds a little complicated. What is atherosclerosis? Okay? Or you get a question on what is angiogram? More easier, right? Do you know what is angiogram? You all heard about it, I'm sure, but you don't know what it is. What do you do in angiogram? Heart rate. Okay, it is something connected to heart problems. Okay, angiogram is a diagnostic tool, basically doing X-ray to see if blood vessels are stuck anywhere. Because you know that heart attack, stroke, it is due to the disturbance in blood supply. If blood supply stops to brain, you'll get stroke. If blood supply stops to heart, it will cause heart attack. Okay, so like that, we have different reasons for that. But to be able to understand, we need to know how heart functions. And it's really difficult to learn about heart. Heart is like a machine that you use at home, water machine, water pumping machine. but instead of pumping water, it is pumping blood. And for any pumping machine, you need different connections, right? First of all, you need to understand what type of blood do I need. We have pure blood, we have impure blood. Pure means what? Does it purify it somehow? Oxygenated blood. Okay, so there are two sides of the heart. One side carries the pure blood, that is oxygenated blood. Another side carries the impure blood, non-oxygenated blood. Because what happens if you carry oxygen to various parts of your body? They consume oxygen. Okay, and once they consume oxygen, blood will not have oxygen anymore. It will come back to other side of the heart and go to lungs. Will collect more oxygen that we are breathing in, and will again go and supply it. Learning about that is circulatory system. And once we know what is the normal way of its functioning, any deviation from that will be a problem. Heart attacks are the problem, and sometimes, you know, we develop infections in the heart. We have issues in the formation of different parts in the heart. Okay, like that, we will learn basically what heart is, how heart functions. Why do we take, you know, intravenous injections? Why don't we take intra-artery injections? How arteries are different from veins? Why our blood actually looks, it looks like as if it is green. If you are thin like me and if you see veins, it looks like blood is green. Why does it look that, We'll talk about a physical phenomena, physics phenomena here about light. So there are so many aspects interesting to know. Forget about the exam. If you actually keep learning, they're really interesting, right? And if you are interested in things like that, it won't become that difficult to prepare for exam because it's part of your interest. I think that is key. It doesn't matter whether it is biology. I am excited about biology, so I talk about biology like that. Could be anything like economics, could be maths, doesn't matter. Whatever you are studying, if you create that interest, you will actually get most out of it from these classes. Okay, so influence your mind positively. All these things will fall into place provided you really want it. Okay, so we are talking about the aspects in biology, human physiology, like example I gave about heart structure. We'll talk about lungs. We'll talk about digestion. I'll walk you through how digestion process happens when you are eating. What happens? What are the different enzymes in our body? We all know that, you know, if you don't eat on time, like you feel a burning sensation in your stomach. That is because of an acid. What is that acid? Hydrochloric acid. Why do you need acid in the stomach? Digestion. But we have so many other things. Why acid? Basically, HCl is required to activate one enzyme called pepsin. Pepsin actually digests the proteins, right? We eat plant proteins and make the units of the proteins, that is amino acids, and build our own proteins from that. Like that, we'll talk about different aspects. And then we'll talk about abnormalities. Once the digestion happens, sometimes we hear about appendicitis. What is appendicitis? I'll also walk you through terminology, how to remember terms, because one of the biggest problem in biology is the way it is shown. Angiogram sounds like, you know, very complicated, right? But it is simply looking at blood vessels and if something stuck in the blood vessels. So terminology is very difficult. If you really understand and how to read this terminology, everything looks easy because that's us. That's what happens in our body. Okay, so we'll go through. For example, we took the oxygen, lungs process that information. And lungs, what is our metro system inside? We have a public transport system inside. Do you know that? Like blood circulatory system. Everything gets into blood. It will be carried to various parts. Oxygen, we breathe, goes to lungs and enters into blood. Food that we eat gets digested in the stomach, will enter into blood. Hormones. Our brain is a key CPU of our body, right? It controls all parts of our body. So what does it do? It will send hormones to control it. It will tell thyroid, now it's a time to behave. It will tell the stomach or the kidneys, adrenal glands on the kidneys. Let's say you went out, you're normally a weak person, you don't fight with anybody. But there is a situation that you have to fight. Let's say you have a brother, small brother or small sister. Somebody hitting her or hitting him. What do you do? You'll go and hit that person. Where do you get that courage from? Did you build your muscles in those few minutes? No. But hormones, your hormone level, adrenaline level increases. You will get that power. Either to hit someone or run, right? We learn about those concepts in hormones. Okay, like that, various parts. I'll also teach about reproductive system, how women are different from men, what are the different events that takes place. We'll talk about twins, how twins are produced, why identical twins, why non-identical twins. Okay, all those aspects. And this is very similar to what I teach in UPSC. I will teach for civils as well, but same aspects, but civils we teach at a different depth. But here it will be little more superficial depending on the questions that you get. Questions they will ask you, what is this disease? There's a disease called emphysema. They'll ask you what emphysema is connected to. Have you heard about this disease? Emphysema means when people smoke too much, they damage some parts in the lungs called alveoli. Okay, this situation is called emphysema. So only knowing what emphysema and what is it connected to is enough. Atherosclerosis, nothing but cholesterol building up in blood vessels. It is called atherosclerosis. Sounds little scary, right? Why someone has to come up with these kind of names? I think if we do well in science in India, we will give our Indian names. Okay, we don't have to call them with their names. We can call Naveen, we can call Rajesh, we can give our own names. But the problem is our contribution is too little towards science. That's why we have to hear French names, German names. That is what makes biology complicated. If you want to contribute more towards biology, do more research and more learning in biology. Okay, so like that, there are many aspects, different types of systems we learn. I'll briefly go through skeletal system, key bones in our body. I will take about 15 classes for biology, teaching all these aspects. Okay, and not only human physiology, not only little bit about microorganisms, not only little plants. I'll deal with, there are key other areas in biology which you see many more questions coming from that area. Do anyone know which area I'm talking about? What are the areas that I have not mentioned about that you get questions in biology? Nutrition. Vitamins. Chemical names of vitamins. How is vitamin B called? How is vitamin C called? Then how is vitamin C called? Some acid, right? What acid is it? Ascorbic acid. Ascorbic acid. Okay. Where does it? What do we have to eat to get vitamin C? And deficiency of vitamin C, what disease does it cause? There's a chart, if you really by heart, there's a good chance of getting questions from that. But knowing it, knowing from the connections that we have in life, I won't teach anything that is not connected to you. Okay, vitamin C, if you don't eat it, or we normally take vitamin C to get immunity, to boost the immunity. Doctors say sometimes, you know, take vitamin C tablets if you're experiencing cold frequently. Okay, because vitamin C improvises our immune system. And what do we eat to get vitamin C? Many citrus fruits, oranges, lemons, for example. And there are some vitamins which are a larger role than we thought about. Vitamin D. Nowadays, if you go to any diagnostic center, you will see 1200 rupees, 1500 rupees to get the vitamin D test done. Why vitamin D test all of a sudden came into the market? Because we are now prone to more vitamin D deficiency. Why? How many of you spend enough time outside in the farm working? How many of you actually see the sun from morning to evening? How many of you see it? Most of us don't. Either we are sitting inside the classroom, are busy in preparing for exams, are busy working in software companies. There is no life that happens outside. And vitamin D only comes from sun or fish. Very, very few resources, like some mushrooms give us vitamin D. Otherwise, we don't get much vitamin D. Most of us are at household. If you're experiencing bone pains, if you're actually, as you're walking, you get muscle cramps, it is a sign that you have vitamin D deficiency. That is why those diagnostic centers are making more money showing you that you have vitamin D deficient. The easiest solution is spend 15-20 minutes a day in the sun, not in the hot sun. If you do in the hot sun, you're more exposed to UV, concept of physics. Okay, so stay in the morning's time, not around the noon, up to 9 o'clock or 10 o'clock or after 3 o'clock. Are these all relevant to us? Is it something you need to know? If you will have kids, would you have to tell them all these things? Okay, so it is not essential just for the exam. It is part of our life. I hope our teachers teach us things like this. Okay, I had a very good science teacher. I had a very good genetics teacher to teach me these things, created interest in me. And we need more such teachers. Okay, coming back to the topics. So I'll cover nutrition and we'll talk about minerals. What are micronutrients? What are macronutrients? What carbohydrates do? What proteins do? What fats do? And fats is a very common topic. We'll talk about what type of food to eat. Right? What type of food gives us more cholesterol? what is bad cholesterol, what is bad like good cholesterol, why heart problems increase with cholesterol. Okay, we'll talk about those aspects in nutrition. Okay, and then I'll also cover some concepts in genetics, understanding connection. We all hear about DNA, we all hear about genes, we all hear about chromosomes. Are they same thing or different things? Don't worry too much, just say what you know. Same thing or different thing, two possibilities, right? So knowing the connections, because we always interchangeably use. How do you get the characters from your parents? We say through genes, through chromosomes, through DNA. They all are connected to each other, but in a way they are different. How are they different? We'll talk about that in genetics. Okay, genetic diseases. Some people have, if they have bleeding, there is no blood clotting that happens in them due to very small changes in the DNA causing genetic diseases. Some people outside, they're Indians, they look like foreigners. Why? Color, their complexion. They won't make melanin pigment called albinism. Okay, true in rabbits. Rabbits are not white color. They don't make any color. That's why they are white. And that albinism can be seen in people is a genetic disease. Okay, we learn about those few concepts in genetics. And I'll also teach some aspects of biotechnology. Talking about insulin, why, how insulin is made in biotechnology, what is in vitro fertilization technology, what is stem cell therapy. Okay, those common aspects. What is DNA fingerprinting? Dr. Lalji Singh, have you heard about Dr. Lalji Singh? Dr. Lalji Singh, about 1.5 months ago, December 1st week or 2nd week, he passed away. He is the father of DNA fingerprinting in India. And he actually worked in Hyderabad, Center for Cellular and Molecular Biology, CCMB. Okay, he's right here. He is there. He was the director of CCMB. And he is the reason behind solving cases of Rajiv Gandhi's assassination, our N.D. Tiwari's dispute. Okay, all those things. Because he's a father. He actually created that field in India. And they can ask questions on these kind of things, knowing what is DNA fingerprinting. Okay, we'll teach those aspects in biotechnology and nutrition and genetics. And another most important thing is how your immune system works. Right? We develop fever. Why do we develop fever? Our skin becomes, sometimes if we have rashes on the skin, it'll become red. When we get infection, our throat actually becomes itchy. We have difficulty in swallowing. It is all part of our immune system responding to infections. Okay, few terms and the process of our different immune responses, and the most importantly, how vaccines work. As soon as we are born, the first and foremost thing that we get is a needle. We get vaccination. As soon as you are born, we get, what vaccine do we get? You know, what vaccines do we get as soon as we are born? What is that? BCG. Okay, BCG for preventing tuberculosis. That has to be given as soon as we are born. Like that, up to 3 to 5 years, if you really follow the procedure, every 1.5 month you have to take vaccines. Why? To prevent many severe diseases. Because of vaccines, today we don't see polio in India, polio free country. We don't see rabies in India. We don't see much tuberculosis. Still tuberculosis exists in India. Okay, but how vaccines work? Why do we take? We actually take some pathogens, or we take a portion of a pathogen. How come taking that will give us immune response? We learn about that in immune system, the concepts of that. Okay, are these all useful to us? Okay, do we get questions on these in the exams? These are the areas where you get the questions. I have not chosen this area out of my interest. These are defined based on the questions that you get in the exam. Okay, but at the groups level, cracking questions like this at biology and physics and chemistry is not very difficult. Only knowing very fundamental things and basic things, which somehow we skipped understanding them. We studied them, but we didn't understand them. Or we don't remember them, so we have gaps. So my goal is to fill those gaps. Okay, right. So that's about different areas in biology, nutrition, genetics, biotechnology, immunology. I'll also deal with cell. I'll cover many important areas in biology in about 15 classes. Okay, and I'll promise you, I'll make this class interesting like this. I hope if you found this interesting, because I'm personally interested. It's not because of anything. I like to teach that way, and I like teachers to actually influence. Doesn't matter, my parents, I'll go and influence my parents and talk to them always about biology. Okay, because that's the interest. Did I really study in physiology? No, I have not studied physiology. My experience is comes from molecular biology and biotechnology, but I am interested in physiology. I always had a physiology book with me because I need to learn more about my how my heart works, how my lungs work at the basic level, not to train someone. Okay, that's about bio. But what do we deal? And we'll have a test at the end of this. We will have classes, and the way I teach classes, I use board and I always use PowerPoint presentations, because I believe seeing things makes much more difference than me talking like this for 1 hour, right? If I talk to you like this, if I ask you what did I teach 10 minutes ago, would you be able to tell me? No. But seeing those things, first and foremost thing that image does is it will activate your brain. As soon as you see nice colors, you get interest to look at it, what it is, like flowers, like colorful birds, like butterflies. Same thing. I normally show you, I also talk about brain structure, brain function, very basic level, but I'll show you the parts of the brain. I'll show you how blood system circulation works, how lungs connected to, because I believe that's the way it should be taught. Okay, but wherever possible, I actually teach them on the board. Once we get the concept, we'll switch. Okay, that's my way of teaching, and I'm seeing that students are liking it. I hope you like that too. So let's move on to the physics and chemistry part. What areas do we need to know in physics and chemistry? What are the areas that are useful to us? Have you seen one very common physical phenomena 2-3 days ago on Wednesday? What is that phenomena? Lunar eclipse. How lunar eclipse forms? What is that phenomena? What is that concept in physics? You have to speak a little louder or I have to come to you. Exactly. What happens if it comes in between? Concept is very simple, shadow. See the shadow effect. It is not Rahu or is it not Ketu? Maybe not. We don't know who is eating it. And it could be just a simple concept of physics where you have Earth coming in between. Okay. Sun is huge. Earth is kind of a medium and moon is so small. And can we see it? The shadow is huge, like as if, you know, one big person is standing next to you and nobody can see you. In the pictures, when we take pictures, if someone standing before you and you're taking a picture, can you be seen in the picture? It is very similar to that. Okay. Does moon actually give light? Do you know that moon actually shines? Where does moon get light from? He basically borrows that light from sun. Sunlight reflects on the moon and we are able to see because of the sunlight. And if you are coming in between the source, what happens? There is no light falling on the moon. We cannot see him. That is lunar eclipse. Okay. But why that moon is red? Red blood moon. We called blue moon and red blood moon. Why is that the case? Why? Have you seen? Have you looked at the moon that day? It was red. Why red? Little light actually escapes from this and falls on moon. And why red? Because red is the least scattered light. That is why we see it. That is why our dangerous signals are red. So we learn those kind of aspects in physics. Okay, I'll go topic wise. I deal with in physics. I'll start talking about starting from the units. Okay, and we'll talk about light. We'll talk about heat. Okay, I will talk about electricity. We'll talk about magnetism. Okay, and we'll talk about radioactivity. If you know about what powers sun, no, sun is like a burning goal, right? What is happening inside the sun? What is the reaction? There's a helium and hydrogen. What's happening? Nuclear? It's interestingly not fission, it's fusion. Okay, small molecules are joining, but joining molecules, why does it release heat? So much of heat. We learn about it in radioactivity. And how come we can extract this energy, mainly nuclear fission, in nuclear reactors? Okay, you get questions from this sometimes, especially at the civils level. The process components in the nuclear reactors. Hydrogen bomb, atomic bombs, we'll talk about those concepts. Radioactive isotopes, used in treatment of thyroid problems, diagnosis of thyroid. We'll learn about those in everyday activity. Magnetism, magnet trains in Japan, how do they work? Using magnetism. Okay, and we'll talk about some natural phenomena that happens in, I don't know if you remember this, Aurora Borealis, the beautiful colors display that happens because of magnetism. Electricity, we'll talk about basic fundamentals of electricity. Okay, transformers, AC, DCs, most of you know that better than me. And some of those we'll talk about what are capacitors, what are inverters, what are LED lights, how normal bulbs work. Because the questions are getting, you are getting very basic. How is the filament made in the bulb? What gas is present in the bulb? Do you know how is the filament made? What is it made up of? Tungsten. Why tungsten? Its melting temperature is too high, about 2000 to 3000 degrees centigrade. And we don't want, because normally bulb works by converting electrical energy into heat. And we need that filament that handles the heat. But if it comes to tube lights, it is a different phenomena. You are not converting that into heat, you are converting that into fluorescence. And we need different components, there is a different gas inside this. And now comes to LEDs. Why LEDs are those tiny, tiny, tiny bulbs? Why not bigger ones? And why LED wattage is smaller than the fluorescent tubes, are smaller than our regular bulbs? Those aspects we learn in physics. Okay, because you'll get questions on those concepts and heat, principles of heat, conductors, insulators, the different aspects of heat. We'll talk about what radiation actually gives the heat. Why, you know, we experience the hot air from the oceans or seas when we sit near that place. What causes monsoons? Okay, those kind of aspects we'll talk about. And light also, I talked about this. And why we see certain colors. How rainbow is formed. Why things in the water pool looks different. Why it looks elevated. What is that physical phenomena behind it? Okay, eclipses, rainbows. We'll talk about how eye functions. Sensory system I'll also cover in biology, but in physics I'll talk about how eye works. Our eye is much better than the cameras, like 1 lakh camera that you can buy, but it is not even close to how our eye works. Have you ever looked at moon outside, leaving lunar eclipse aside? Yes, right? Do you have to zoom in, zoom out to get a clear picture? Nothing. You don't even realize your lens in our eye is zooming. You get a perfect image of that. But for those cameras that we spend lakhs of rupees, you need to set. So we have much, much more complicated and much better system already in our eyes. We learn at basic level. I won't get into the details. I'll teach you few components, why retina, when you do transplantation happens, what part of the eye is actually changed. Because this is the question you are getting in the exams. They'll ask you, when eye transplantation happens, what part of the eye gets transferred? Do you know what part of the eye gets transferred? I'll give you two options, retina, cornea. Retina, that is what makes sense, right? But retina is inside portion of it. Eye, you won't actually take out the eye and put it. You basically put the top layer, that is cornea. Not the retina. But retina is the part that is functioning in the eye. But you need the role of pupils. You need the role of cornea. You need the role of lens. All together function to give us what we see as an image. Okay? So knowing these basic things, cornea. Placing cornea, replacing cornea is what we need. So like that, there are many aspects in physics that you need to learn, which is connected back to biology and also principles that are required for answering questions in the competitive exams. Okay, this is a rough idea about physics. I'll take about 6-7 classes in physics and I'll take another about 7 classes in chemistry. Okay, and chemistry, we will cover all aspects of chemicals that we come across in life. Starting from metals, what are the characteristics of metals? Conductors, semiconductors, superconductors, insulators. Can you give an example about semiconductor? Engineering background, you all might know very well, right? What is it? Germanium, silicon, we use in computers. Silicon Valley, why is it called Silicon Valley? Because IT, all the computers use silicon, and silicon is a semiconductor. Okay, lithium batteries, the batteries that are rechargeable versus cells in the torch light? How are they different from each other? Can you recharge those batteries that you use in the torch light? No. How are they called? They are called primary cells or primary batteries. And the lithium batteries we use in these phones, fancy phones and any phones for that matter, they are rechargeable. How are they different from each other? So like that, there are many, many, many things that we can learn in physics, many things that we can learn in chemistry. Okay? And we'll go through those aspects: helium gas, neon gas, noble gases, explosives, trinitroglycerin, TNT, dynamite, for example. Okay? And how are those jackets made? Jackets, bulletproof jackets made, what material? How is that plastic that we use at home, polythene, made? Why do we do Teflon coating? Once they ask about Teflon, what is Teflon? Teflon chemically. So those questions we'll go through. We'll go through what are the different aspects of chemistry that we need to learn in life. Gold, right? We'll talk about percent of gold, right? How do we measure the quality of gold? Carats, right? What is the maximum carats you would get? 24, right? 24 is the max you'll get, which is 100%. What is 10 carats mean? What is 15 carats mean? You'll get questions on that. Being able to simply convert that information into percent of gold. Okay? Silver, why silver turns black? What is the reaction that happens? Why copper turns to green? Okay? Why iron gets rusted? Okay? So we'll go through those kind of aspects in chemistry and physics. This is to give you an example of the range of topics that we will discuss in biology, physics and chemistry. Okay, I already talked too much. Any questions from your side? So I talked about my teaching strategy. I talked about what topics do I cover. Institute gives you material to read about all these things, but most of the running notes from my class is enough. Okay, the notes that you make from the class are more than enough. And this will make you, they'll prepare you even for other competitive exams, because these are the common concepts whether you are preparing for other regular exams or whether preparing for civils. Topics are same. What varies is the depth. If you are interested in studying for civils, you need to read a little bit more based on what I taught in the class. Any other questions? No? Sometimes we get bored of talking. Okay. Type of questions. Can I ask you a few questions from the exam? See if you know it. I already gave a few examples of those, right? I'm not going to scare you with things like that. Okay. They will ask you basic questions sometimes. Vitamins. Vitamin K. What is the use of vitamin K? Blood clotting. Right? Some of them you already know. Right? And they may ask you about what element is found, what chemical is found in plants, in chlorophyll. Chemistry, question from chemistry, there's one element, okay, is at the center of chlorophyll. What element is it? Potassium. It is magnesium. Magnesium at the center of chlorophyll molecule. Do you know what is at the center of hemoglobin? Iron, right? And iron is what gives us red color. Iron is little brown, but if you have oxygen to it, it looks more red. And hemoglobin, an essential protein found in our RBC, contains iron. Okay? What gas is filled in balloons, floating balloons? Helium. Why helium? Why not other noble gases? Lighter, very lighter. What chemical is used in making batteries? Lithium. Okay. What are those signs that we see on the roads, danger signs, which actually fluoresce in the night? Radium. Okay. Certain things are easy to answer. Certain questions are easy to answer. What instrument is used to measure blood pressure? Sphygmomanometer. Do you know what is the pressure on top, what is the pressure at the bottom? Systolic pressure, diastolic pressure. What does systolic pressure means? What is diastolic pressure means? Where is it coming from? from arteries, okay, because blood travels at a high pressure in the arteries. So you are measuring that pressure that blood applies on the walls, diastolic and systolic pressure. Do you know what makes that lub dub sound? Contraction of heart. But what part of that makes that lub or dub sound? Walls. We have walls in the heart. They'll close. They like gates. They open, and as soon as actually blood goes down, they close, making that sound. And there are another set of walls at the bottom of the heart. They'll make next sound. So that's what you hear as a lub dub sound. Okay. These kind of basic things that you need to know that you might get questions on. Let me see if I can pull more questions. They'll ask some simple questions. Icrisat, where is Icrisat present? In Hyderabad, right? Where is Center for DNA fingerprinting technology is present? Hyderabad. Where is Indian Institute of Science? I'm sure most of you know it. Indian Institute of Science is in Bangalore. National Cell Sciences, NCS, Pune. National Chemical Laboratories, Pune. Okay. You probably know this, AIMS, All India Institute of Medical Sciences, New Delhi, these kind of things, institutes, locations, famous scientists, basic concepts, basic definitions, applications. If you cover these things, you will get those 25 marks easily. And some of these questions will also help you in getting the current affairs, answers from current affairs. Okay, that's what you need to learn. Have you ever seen when mosquito comes to you to hit, you will hear that buzzing noise. What makes that buzzing noise? True, basically wings. Wings are actually flapping. It will flap the wings. That noise is coming from the wings. They'll ask you these kind of questions. Okay, pigments. Do we have pigments in our eyes? Do you know what type of pigment we have in our eyes? We have rod cells, cone cells. We have different pigments, rhodopsin, iodopsin. Okay, they will ask you questions on these kind of things. It is not too difficult, okay? You just have to prepare well. India's first genetically engineered vaccine. The question from 2010. Options are malaria, hepatitis B, BCG, FMD. FMD means foot and mouth disease. What vaccine is the first recombinant vaccine made in India? Made in Hyderabad. Hepatitis B. It's talking about Shanta Biotech. Made hepatitis B vaccine. Exports to many countries around the world. Vaccine for 50 rupees. Not even $1. You can't even buy tea or coffee in US. But you get the vaccine. Okay? So, those kind of questions can come in the exam. Icrisat, I already asked about. The percentage of water in milk is measured with, what is that? Lactometer. You know what are you measuring here? Density. Basically density of milk compared to water. It is called lactometer. Do you know there is an instrument to measure how much we respire? What is that instrument called that measures the respiration, rate of respiration? It is not that BP machine, it is not sphygmomanometer we hear about this. We don't always hear about this. But there is a machine that measures how much air you are inhaling, how much air you are exhaling. You know what is this machine called? You only need to know once. You will remember it. It is not difficult one, but you never heard about it. It is called, either it is called spirometer. But does it make sense why it is called spirometer? It is also called respirometer. Is it not easy to remember? Respiration, respirometer. But it is also called spirometer to make our life complicated. But if you know once, you will identify this out of the four options, right? So sometimes you only need to hear about it. You don't even need to by heart. Okay, right. So that's about the overview about type of questions, how many marks are you getting from it, and what are the topics that are going to be covered. Did I actually stimulate any questions in the class? No? Okay. So if not, If you don't have any questions, then we'll stop the class here. I'll see you in coming classes. Okay? Right. Thank you then.